It's a beautiful day on the campus of the University of Arkansas and a great night for baseball in Fayetteville. The Hogs homestand at Palm Walker Stadium continues with a two-game midweek series as the Grand Canyon Lopes come to town to face the 15th-ranked Arkansas Razorbacks. And we welcome you to the broadcast booth. I'm Brett Dolan. He is Troy Eklund. And you go back to Saturday, the Razorbacks had dropped five straight games. The sky wasn't falling, but for a few it may have felt that way. But Arkansas pounded out a win on Saturday. And, Troy, there's nothing to lift a team's spirits like a dramatic win on Sunday.
You're exactly right. Boy, when the team's scuffling five losses in a row, any win is big. And, boy, that walk-off was huge for Arkansas.
Runs were awfully tough to come by on Sunday, but Heston Kerstad came up in the bottom of the ninth with a chance to win it.
Well, Mr. Clutch right there. The wind's blowing in about 20 miles an hour, and Kerstad hits an absolute missile right through that wind. You can see it turns the outfield around. It doesn't get out by much, Brett, but hey, a home run's a home run.
Indeed, and watch the celebration that was awaiting Kerstad at home plate as the Hogs had a 5-3 dramatic walk-off win to take the series against South Alabama. And again, it was a lengthy week when you go back, Troy, to the three games the previous weekend. Good competition, lost all three in Houston, but it was the loss to Illinois State and the game on Friday that were frustrating for these Razorbacks.
Well, I think they were right. Illinois State threw their best pitchers, but that's what Arkansas is going to see. South Alabama just jumped out on the Hogs early, but you know, you see those five losses and just on a skid, but Arkansas feels like they've really righted the ship.
Well, midweek pitching is the land of opportunity, and the Wheel of Fortune has stopped on Will McIntyre.
Well, McIntyre, he's only had one outing, was outstanding. Everything he throws moves, big overhand curve, so let's see if the Lopes can deal with that.
Here's the batting lineup for Grand Canyon, a team that hits 233. It'll be Ortiz, Collado, and Best, their big three up top, and then Drew Smith, the cleanup hitter, followed by Burton, Grissom, Aguilar, Avidia, and Goelko. Under head coach Andy Stankiewicz, we'll talk more about him as this game progresses. Good weather tonight. We're underway with strike one to Channy Ortiz, the Lopes shortstop. It's a Grand Canyon team that comes in 9-7. Got roughed up a bit on Sunday, but won a series against Pacific, and they're used to stepping up in competition. Play a lot of Big 12 teams when they're not in the WAC conference, and this is a big test this week. Two at Arkansas and then three this weekend at Baylor.
Yeah, head coach Andy Stankiewicz, he's not afraid to schedule some really good competition, and that's how you get on the map in college baseball.
Good beginning for McIntyre, and there's a wave of a miss. And Troy, he is continuing where he left off a couple of days ago.
Well, he really is. Not overpowering, but just great stuff and really good command of that breaking ball.
Here's the defense behind him. No surprise, Webb, Franklin, and Kerstad in that outfield. Nesbitt and Martin on the left side of the diamond. Moore and Austin on the right, and Opitz catching McIntyre. Faced six, retired six, and struck out four on Saturday. Here's Juan Collado. He's a good hitter, and he'll rope one up the middle for a base hit. Came in hitting 366, and he'll add to that number.
The top of this Lopes lineup is where they do damage. So McIntyre's going to have to really make sure he's careful with these leadoff hitters at 1, 2, 3, 4.
He'll work out of the stretch for the first time in his career. Here's Cuba Bess. A lot of preseason accolades for Bess. He's had just three at-bats. He's been dealing with a nagging hamstring tweak. Preseason All-American by some publications.
Boy, Brett, he sure passes the eye test, doesn't he?
Yes, he does.
Big-bodied first baseman. He just looks like a guy with power.
Lopes get him back just as they're losing their Friday night starter, maybe for a period of time. That one's up there a long time for Martin. Well, that thing was in the air forever. Casey makes the catch for the second out.
That was a punt that had some serious hang time, didn't it?
It's dropped out of an airplane. It wouldn't have taken that long to come down. First night game of the year. We got that bright sunshine way out there in left field and shadows across most of the infield as Drew Smith steps in. We're going to have a lot of fun introducing you to Drew Smith as this two-game series goes along, but hitting 323 on the year. There's Andy Stankiewicz over there coaching at third base. Well, he was a grinder in his professional career between the majors and AAA. Good baseball guys. Happy to be there at Grand Canyon in the Phoenix area. Off and running goes Collado. The throw from Opitz is there waiting for Robert Moore. And Troy, the caught stealing ends the inning.
Boy, what a great throw on a ball that bounced in the dirt. Great arm by Opitz right on the money to Robert Moore. Hogs coming up.
We've all been here before. The conference room, the speakerphone, the missing files. Not in the room, then you're not in the know. Well, this has been nice, but can we not? Microsoft Teams invites everyone you work with to work together. Be seen, be heard, be there when you're not. Share your files and your opinion, and maybe even a happy little fruit guy. When you're ready to unleash the power of your team, open Teams.
Taking the hill tonight for the Lopes, left-hander Cal Lambert.
So Lambert's going to be a guy that's going to be in that mid to upper 80s with a fastball. Really good curve and a nice change as well. He'll throw that change a lot to right-hand batters. But according to Andy Stankiewicz, his head coach, he said he's going to have to work down in the zone and hit his spots.
Take a look at the lineup he will be facing tonight for the Razorbacks. And right back in those top two spots, the duo that's done some damage, Franklin and Kerstad. Goodhart bats third, Martin the cleanup hitter. Then it's Webb, Opitz, and Nesbitt. Moore batting eighth, Cole Austin batting ninth for DBH.
Probably the most consistent hitter Arkansas has had all season is Christian Franklin. Just game in, game out, Mr. Steady Eddie.
Four straight multi-hit games, 10 hits in his last four games, 10 for 17. His average a couple of points higher than Kerstad. And it was Franklin who got the two-out single Sunday in the ninth inning that gave Kerstad a chance to get up there, bat, and win the game. And, Troy, when you consider the Razorbacks had not had a hit since the third inning until that ninth, that was quite a drought.
Yeah, it really was. And Dave Van Horn talked about that around the batting cage today. He said, boy, we just had a drought right there, but both teams did.
Pitches on that outside corner, says Rick Allen. Franklin rung up, and Cal Lambert has a strikeout.
Now batting for the
Here's the defense for the Lopes. Aguilar, Burke, and Goelko. It's Collado and Ortiz on the left side, Smith and Bess on the right. Avidia, good throw and catcher behind the plate for Cal Lambert. Freshman out of Sandra Day O'Connor High School in Phoenix. Left on left, and Kerstad nearly took out his first base coach, Taylor Smart.
Gonna be on your toes down there in the first base coaching box with Kerstad in the up there swinging the stick.
Six home runs, 19 knocked in for Kerstad, who has hit in every game this year. 14 straight. His hitting streak goes back to last year's 15 games. It's a good test for Lambert. This young man, the freshman, is making his eighth appearance of the year already, Troy. He's pitched a lot of one-inning stints. Stop that with the bunny.
You just wonder what's going through Dave Van Horn's head right here. It's like, why?
Grand Canyon's been talking for 2 days on how to keep Kerstad in the park, and he tried to bunt in the first inning. And that one bounced several feet in front of the plate. But Lambert, Troy, for this his eighth appearance. He has already, as a freshman, pitched against Oklahoma State, Oregon, a couple of times against Stanford, and now gets the start on the road in favor.
That's like being thrown in the deep end of the pool when you don't know how to swim. Let's see if you can figure it out.
What did Andy Stankiewicz tell us today? What better time to grow up than pitching against this team in this park? Kerstad, no likey, that big curve. Did he get a piece? I think he did. Barely.
One thing that Lambert's going to do, he's not going to blow it past anybody, but he's got some really good off-speed pitches, and that's what Arkansas is going to have to do is get him up in the zone, lay off things down out of the strike zone. That's what he wants to do is expand that strike zone.
Smoked off Lambert. Kerstad might have an infield hit, and he will. And that's how his hitting streak reaches 15, a hit off the pitcher, literally.
That's where you have to go out there and check on your pitcher and make sure he's okay. I'm not sure where that caught him. See if he even hit any leather of the glove or it was just all body.
He did get some of the
glove. No, it got glove. Well, if you're going to get hit as a pitcher, that's where you want to get hit, in the mitt. It's almost one of those look what I found mom plays, wasn't it?
That thing was hit pretty well. Here's Goodhart. Average of 273 for Matt. Lambert, though, really wants to get off to a good start, and every pitcher does. I guess that goes without saying. But when he pitched against New Mexico back on the 4th, he went four innings, and his line, you know, five hits, seven runs, it is what it is. But, Troy, he gave up six of those runs in the first inning and then had to, you know, find a way to get through three more.
Yeah, Coach Stankiewicz said, you know, he really kind of grew up and found it. And a lot of times as a coach, you want to see how your players deal with adversity. And he said that Lambert did a really good job of bouncing back.
Goodhart waiting on that 72-mile-an-hour hook and chopped it foul. Just underway, first of a two-game midweek series. The Lopes out of the whack coming to town to face the Hogs out of the SEC. Kirstad runs. It's going to take a good throw down to second, and it was on the money from Bess to Ortiz going on first movement. It'll be a caught stealing going 1-3-6.
So Kirstad's going to go. As soon as that foot comes up, you're going to go. You're not trying to read it, and you just hope you can outrun the baseball. But, you know, good throw right there from Best, the first baseman.
The minor leagues, Troy, they're going to change that where you can't lean and throw. You're going to have to step off the rubber with the thought it might entice the running game because you can't just hang and drift. You're either going to have to step off or those first movement stolen bases are going to be a little more prevalent.
Well, that's an interesting ruling.
Want to take away that Andy Pettit type move?
Arkansas fans way back in the day whenever I played, left-hander Ray Harris was one of the best guys I've ever saw that did that. He literally could hang up there and read his foot never stopped, but he could read the runner, and then he could either go to the plate and still throw strikes.
That's the key.
That is the key.
Count has gone full to Goodhart. Batting with the bases empty. That was 69 miles an hour and missing.
Again, that's where Arkansas is going to have to lay off those pitches down in the zone.
Stevie H, win tonight, a win tomorrow would let him reach that 700 plateau. He may not even be aware of that number, unless somebody close to him is telling him.
It's just another game for him.
It's Casey Mark.
I was lucky enough to play under Norm DeBrien, and when he got his 700th win, that was a pretty cool.
That's a big number.
Yeah, really is.
Here's Casey Martin. Pitch just a little bit up and out. That at 80 on the gun. We were in San Diego State a couple of years ago when DVH got number 600. You know they had a rainout tonight in San Diego State against TCU? I didn't think
really?
It ever rained in San Diego.
I didn't either.
Not enough to rain out a game.
Maybe everybody freaked out and nobody wanted to drive in the rain to get to the park. That's probably what happened.
It's a pretty good pitch to Casey. I emailed the TCU SID and I said, it doesn't rain in San Diego State. And she replied back, I hereby refute that statement.
She had to send you some video proof, huh?
Slow bender drops in. Those pitches have to stop for refueling halfway to the plate. You can see where they lock up some of these hitters.
All right, you just give up on it. Out of the hand, you think it's going to be up in the zone.
Martin will wave and miss. Went out after that slow breaking ball, and the Hogs get a hit and a walk, but leave a runner. Zeros up on the scoreboard as we head to the second at Bomb Walk.
Who do you think of when I say hero? Is it someone in a cape or is it someone you know? In SEC country, being a hero means tutoring a struggling student, feeding hungry neighbors in your community, or showing up at a hospital to make a child's day a little brighter. Heroes are all around us, and Belk wants to celebrate them with what we're calling Project Hometown Heroes. We'll show you everyday heroes that are strengthening the communities around the SEC. Now, who do you think of when I say hero? Learn more at belk.com/projecthometown.
Show me reality. TV.
Where my hobbits at? Play Lord of the Rings.
Play my Straight Out of the Shire playlist.
I want to see the king. Find LeBron.
Search more cartoons.
Play the last OG.
Take me to the streets. Play Sesame Street.
Me want more cookies.
Soft and cookie-like on the inside.
Find the things you love with the voice command. Introducing AT&T TV. With live TV and access to streaming apps, visit att.com/TV.
HelloFresh. I can always count on you.
So my days can get pretty jam-packed, whether I have a 14-hour day on set or a writing session. It's so important for me that I take the best care of myself that I can. And that's why HelloFresh is important to me, because what I put in my body determines what I get out of it. These are all fresh ingredients. They're delicious, and they make me feel incredibly healthy. HelloFresh is my secret tool to feeling my best and doing my absolute best.
Go to HelloFresh.com and use code YUM10 for 10 free meals, including free shipping.
There are people from all over the region that are here in Nashville. Let's put on a show, Jim. Cause they ain't never seen me fall under pressure. They ain't never ever seen me fall, nah, never. Always keep one up on them cause I'm too clever.
We gotta play inspired!
Yeah, where you been? Where you been? When it was time to do some work and put it in. Never lose, I go overtime on them. Stay in that gym, let's get it.
Cause I've been on the road, they on the road.
Well, the Lopes are in town from Grand Canyon. It's a team that has a lot of newcomers, a lot of returning pitchers, but Troy, it's the position players that they've had a lot of JUCO guys and newcomers that have tried to fill in.
Boy, they've really had some guys that stepped up. You see the numbers right there, Smith, Collada, and Grissom. The average for Grissom's down a little bit, but four bombs and 13 RBIs early on, and those are the guys that they want to kickstart that lineup and that offense for the Lopes.
Here's one of those JUCO guys, Drew Smith, and he lines one right to Martin, one pitch, one out.
Boy, Smith hit one, that one on the screws, but right at Martin.
And why would you ask would they have that much turnover? How about the fact that Grand Canyon had five players drafted last year?
Yeah, that was impressive, and we talked about Andy Stankiewicz, his time in the big leagues, and so, you know, he knows how to get players ready for that next level baseball.
Here's the center fielder, Brock Burton. See a lot of these guys from Arizona, a team that won 36 games a year ago. You think about Grand Canyon, they haven't been at the D1 level that long, but last year they were 4-3 against Pac-12 competition. Andy Stankiewicz not afraid to schedule. And they have nine games this year against Pac-12 teams in addition to this road trip at Arkansas and at Baylor.
Wow, I mean, that's impressive. And, again, you know, that's how you draw kids into a program. You say, hey, you're playing in Arizona and Phoenix. You know, the weather's going to be tremendous. They've got a really nice ballpark they've just built. And then you have some really great competition. So there's a look at Andy Stankiewicz and his career. Like you said, a true grinder.
You know, one common denominator. There's a bouncer to second to Moore. He'll make that play and throw out Brock Burton. Really a guy who had a lot of influence in Stankiewicz's career, Buck Showalter. He played for Buck with the Yankees and then came back and was with the Diamondbacks in 1998 when Showalter was their first manager. That was the first year of that franchise. Buck was a pretty intense guy. He wanted things done the right way.
It says a lot about Stankiewicz.
Grissom will trickle one into left. Martin got a tip of his glove on it, but that'll be a single for Grissom, who is hitting just 196. So McIntyre was hoping for a very quick inning, but a base runner. Talk about a baseball with eyes.
Yeah, seeing eye single right there. Martin, even if he gets to this ball, I don't think there's any way that he's going to get Grissom at first base. Tell you what, when you're scuffling under the Mendoza line, you're looking for anything to get through. That's a gift. You're going to take it.
Here's Taylor Aguilar, the left fielder. He's hitting 143.
you, but whatever I send you, I won't send anybody else.
So. I left my keys here.
Aguilar out of Greeley, Colorado. He hit 445 over 4 years in high school baseball. And, of course, hitting at Greeley is a lot like hitting at Denver, mile high. Ball travels. This one's going to travel just enough to drop in front of Franklin. On his way to third is Grissom. Good throws. They're waiting. Franklin with the gun to cut down Grissom at third base.
Boy, just an outstanding throw by Christian Franklin on a ball that wasn't hit very hard, and the runner just tried to get a little too aggressive. You can see Franklin comes up and he's licking his chops and throws an absolute strike to Jacob Nesbitt.
We've all been here before. The conference room, the speakerphone, the missing files. Not in the room, then you're not in the know. Well, this has been nice, but can we not? Microsoft Teams invites everyone you work with to work together. Be seen, be heard, be there when you're not. Share your files and your opinion, and maybe even a happy little fruit guy. When you're ready to unleash the power of your team, open Teams.
You know, I've had a few walk-off hits or whatever, singles or whatever, but, you know, I've never hit a ball out to end a game, and that stuff I've always thought about from when I was a kid or, you know, when I'd be in the backyard with my brothers or siblings, you know, you'd always, you know, bottom of the ninth, you know, you're the winning run, hit a home run, and it's a walk-off. So that was kind of surreal to be able to be in that situation. And, you know, it was just a lot of fun to be out there with the guys, being able to celebrate that.
He's too good to be true in every aspect.
just a good, humble guy. Yeah, you know, I'd be like, yeah, I took it out. I knew I was going to hit a home run. Yeah, just a really good kid, and he's the type of guy that coaches want on their team. You know, talented and a good leader.
It sent the fans scurrying to the record books to find out the last walk-off home run in Razorback history as Webb singles to begin the second. Troy's the first Arkansas walk-off home run since Joe Serrano versus San Diego State in 2013 in March. Before that, James McCann had one in April of 2011, so this does not happen that often.
No, it really doesn't. The McCann home run was against LSU, and boy, that's probably one of the biggest home runs at Baumwalker Stadium. Really good at-bat right there by Braden Webb, and I think that's the approach right-handers have to take on Cal Lambert is you got to think up the middle the other way.
Here's Casey Opitz. He's fallen just below 300. He threw out a runner trying to steal in the first. On the day that he was named to the Buster Posey watch list by the Greater Wichita Area Sports Commission. Can't believe they have a lot going on for the Greater Wichita Sports Commission, but today they did because they put out their watch list.
Had a big meeting, didn't they?
60 players were nominated, and when they start trimming that down, his name's still going to be on that list.
Yeah, one of the best ones in the country, I'm sure. Him and then his teammate on Team USA, Patrick Bailey, who plays at North Carolina State, had the pleasure of calling a couple regionals with him, and really talented catcher.
Didn't he have a ton of home runs the other day?
5 in 1 week. 3 of the 5 were grand slams in a week.
How is that even remotely possible?
I don't know. That's ridiculous.
See Webb at first. Perfect and stolen base tries, but going back to the bag as the pitch is delivered. Snap toss to first. Vidya, Troy, you know, here's a guy that last year was even better throwing out runners than Opitz was.
Yeah, Vidya is an outstanding catcher, and talking about his throwing skills, I think if he would have come up throwing right there, he had Webb. He came up, and he was going to throw that ball back to the pitcher, and Webb was a mile off first.
Lambert with the move to first. Look at that percentage, 50%. Now, Opitz was just below 50%. Langoliers was taken, I don't know, fifth or sixth overall in the draft at a Baylor. That's a pretty good company.
Yeah, those numbers are really ridiculous.
Opitz will single to left. And back-to-back base hits for the Hogs in their second. And maybe this team would like to find out what it's like to score first.
Yeah, they've been digging themselves a hole, and I tell you, that's tough. Casey Opitz, he didn't really hit this one on the screws, but, hey, it got through there, and Arkansas's got a little something brewing here in the second.
South Alabama scored first in every game this past weekend after Illinois State did the same thing last Tuesday.
it can start getting in your head a little bit, and then you start pressing at the plate when you get behind, and especially after you lost five in a row.
Here's Nesbitt.
Boy, Lambert's done a great job with just kind of living on that outside corner with that fastball. That's what you have to do. If you're not out overpowering, you've got to be able to spot your fastball where you want to.
So the last time I believe Arkansas scored first was the finale of that Gonzaga series. It was last month.
I was going to say, that's February, isn't it?
Razorbacks with some traffic, the Webb single. Braden Webb's quietly had a good couple of series, and Casey Opitz at first.
Well, not only for Arkansas that it puts pressure on the offense, but think about what it does to the pitching staff. If you're always pitching from behind, you feel like you have to be perfect. You feel like you can't afford to give up any more runs.
Well, there's truth to that.
See how the Lopes are playing Jacob Nesbitt. Defensively, the center fielder, Burton, swung around just a few steps toward left field.
Lambert tied up at Nesbitt with an inside fastball.
Lambert won't come inside very often, but when he does, you have to make sure you get it in. You can't leave it out over the plate, and that was a excellent pitch, really handcuffed Nesbitt.
How about Lambert wearing the sleeves on both arms?
Going old school, isn't
it? Probably feels like the 70 degrees feels like what would it be for 40 for us coming out of Phoenix. He's trying to tuck that jersey in.
Surprised he didn't have like a hand warmer thing on on his back. Little pouch thing like quarterbacks wear.
Tell you what, I like their old style stirrup socks though.
Oh.
They're going old school today with those stirrups.
It's way back.
That's a handsome look. Chopper, fair, past Bass. And the Hogs will score first as Braden Webb touches, and it's 1-0 Arkansas. Boy, they've had a couple of choppers that have found just the right spot for base hits.
Boy, sometimes you don't have to hit the ball on the screws, just find a hole. And that's what Nesbitt does right there, just a chopper. Look how far the first baseman Bass is off the bag. Boy, he almost speared that thing. Being right-handed, it made that play a little closer. Webb scores easily with the RBI by Jacob Nesbitt.
Ninth run batted in for Nesbitt. Nobody out. Here's Robert Moore. Moore batting 278. For tomorrow's game, I'm going to have to figure out how many different spots in the lineup Moore has batted this year. It feels like he's seen a bunch, but Troy, he was 1-for-14 this weekend against South Alabama.
Yeah, scuffled just a bit. He kind of started off the season slow, then he got red hot, and he's had a little bit of a dip again. But I just like the way his approach to the plate.
That one went through Lambert and off Smith. And that base hit will chase home a run. Boy, that thing took a couple of lopes with it, nearly into center field.
Boy, the Arkansas Razorbacks are just getting the lucky bounces right now. Balls that are just almost being played right between the legs of Lambert, and then it caroms off the second baseman. Smith almost got that ball. Great heads-up base running by Jacob Nesbitt going first to third right there after the deflection.
Boy, they might have to go play some billiards or some pool after the game. Everything would be dropping. Boy, those stirrups from Lambert just about went into center field. That ball was torched by Moore as Blake Hawksworth. It's a great story in and of himself as he makes his way out to the mound. I'll tell you more about Hawksworth as this series progresses, but right now the Hogs have four straight hits to start their second inning.
But Brett, you just think about the bounces and the plays that Arkansas has been the on the positive side of all those miscues. They're not miscues, just balls that found holes.
Here's Cole Austin. Not a shred of squaring the bunt. trying to continue this stretch in this second inning where the Hogs put up four straight hits and then trying to turn this lineup over for Franklin, who's on deck.
Defensively, the Lopes, they're just looking for outs at this point. Around the diamond, playing double play depth. Moore has kind of a unique lead.
He gets up
there and he kind of turns his body in that foot, almost like he's in a starting block.
TCU has done a lot of this in recent years, where it looks like they're almost crooked over there. And I guess there's some strategy behind it, where you feel like you either have a better look at the pitcher or put you in a better position to take those first two steps.
I think it is. You know, it's almost getting that those shoulders turned just a bit. And that's usually the difference of guys that are fast but not good base stealers. Just to try to get that first step and get those shoulders turned is kind of a chore, and you're thinking, okay, I'm just going to open up just a little bit more. And you can see he's about
good shot.
Kind of a three-quarters angle right there.
He's going to back to the bag on 3-0. Didn't want to get picked off. And Cold Austin looks at a strike. Gregory's played some first in this homestand. Austin's been given his chance. Hitter's count. Boy, that'll have you frustrated. 86 miles an hour on a 3-1 pitch.
Yeah, and you got beat. I think he was thinking he was going to get something a little softer.
Guessing you're right. I'm guessing he was guessing that. That's what he was going to get. Moore draws a throw, able to get back in standing.
The left-handed pitcher, I think Moore's probably going to stay put, or if he does take off, he's going to make sure that Lambert goes to the plate before he's off towards second base.
Fouled away. Hey, speaking of foul balls, how about the finish to the Arkansas softball game today? They were playing Kansas in a doubleheader. Down 2-0 going to the seventh. They score two runs to tie. Load the bases, two outs. Ryan Jackson steps in, and on her 17th pitch, she takes a hit-by-pitch to win the game.
Wow.
17 pitches. Lead runner Morris retired. Austin reaches. A run will score, and the Razorbacks have a 3-0 lead.
17 pitches. And that's the thing that's so hard, is for a pitcher to continue to throw strike after strike after strike.
Well, it's hard for a batter to foul that many off without getting tired herself, right? And just saying, uncle. But then a hit-by-pitch on the 17th to walk off a win.
Now, didn't they walk the bases loaded? Wasn't that an intentional walk? There was,
with one out, and there was a fly ball, and then it became an epic showdown. Franklin struck out to begin the first inning and takes a strike here from Lambert. Never know what you're going to see whenever you go out to the old ball yard.
I tell you what, it's how many times you say, well, I've never seen that before.
Franklin tried to hit one to the hog pen.
Yeah, 88 miles an hour in that last fastball. It was the best one by Lambert so far tonight.
Two strikes on Franklin. That was Razorbacks high in his jersey. A three-run second inning. Arkansas far from done. Well, that thing came out slippery.
That had some gravity working on that one, didn't it? I think Arkansas is happy just to start putting some crooked numbers up on the board. Up until the game on Saturday, they were really scuffling. They could chip away a run here and a run there, but it seems like the offense is really starting to woken up.
Franklin has gone down on strikes both times. Two outs in the inning.
Lambert's not afraid to challenge Franklin inside. Really tied him up with that fastball, and that's the thing. You've got to have enough velocity to be able to pitch inside when you need to. You see Franklin just going right over the top.
Left on left for Kerstad, who got an infield base hit to extend his hitting streak to 15 games in the first. He's halfway to the record.
He's halfway. Got a ways to go.
That's a nice hitting streak. And then if somebody would tell Heston, hey, by the way, you're only halfway to the record, you got to do this again to get there, might seem like a little much. Well, he could have swung at that pitch twice.
He thought about it and then thought about it again.
He flinched multiple times. 50 pitches for Lambert trying to get through this second inning. A little bit of luck here and there, and this inning would have been over, but Lambert still up there dealing.
Yeah, the ball hasn't actually bounced the way of the Lopes so far in this inning.
Team pitching staff, and again, they lost their number one guy, who really, truly one of the best pitchers in the country, but their earned run average was sub three. They're in the top 50 in the country in earned run average. And if your earned run average in Arizona is top 50, that the grading on the curve, that's like top 20 anyplace else.
Right. Yeah. The heat and the ball's really going to carry Kerstad getting a three-run breaking ball down in the dirt. Not a bad decision right there by Lambert.
There's their team earned run average, right? And that ratio of walks per nine innings, pretty low. The loss, though, of their Friday night guy is going to be a painful one if he's out long.
Yeah, it's a tough break for Lopes. You can't really afford to lose any pitching, especially your A's.
Cade Meckles. Sweeping curve in for a strike to Goodhart.
Again, as a hitter, you see that ball out of the hand of the pitcher, and you're thinking, okay, there's no way that's going to fall in for a strike. Just big depth on that overhand breaking ball.
Poked into left, another one that'll dribble for a base hit. Austin will turn and score, and the Razorbacks have played it four this inning.
Again, the balls haven't been hit very sharply by Arkansas, but have definitely found some holes. This one hit off the end of the bat by Goodhart. He just kind of guided that one through. You can see it bounce like four times before it got to the grass of the outfield. No chance to get Cole Austin at the plate.
Brings up Martin as the ninth man to hit this inning after the Goodhart single. Pitcher I was talking about, Meckles, he won 11 games last year with an ERA barely above two. Was drafted, came back to school, so that's what they're missing out on the weekend. Casey struck out back in the first. Nate Thompson.
Nice spear by Nate Thompson.
Boy,
he had to climb the ladder just
a
bit on that one.
But that effort.
Still got some game over there, doesn't he?
He had to collect, kind of bring that thing in.
He's like, eh. Yeah.
It's not that hard.
It's another day at the office.
Martin takes, and that's the high strike. I think that's probably the worst pitch for Casey because you're trying to see up and you're trying not to chase, and that pitch is one that you could handle, but it begins to enlarge that zone.
Well, the thing that Casey did in that last pitch, he really took that pitch out on his front foot, so he's got to keep that weight back.
Nearly took one off his back foot after being out on the front foot. 4 runs home this inning. See Kerstad at second, Goodhart at first. Well, Martin and Franklin have each struck out twice through 2 innings, but a good frame for Arkansas. Score 4 this inning, and Troy, they had eyes this frame.
Boy, they really did. And Arkansas got a big hit by Jacob Ness, but just a chopper down the first base line for an RBI single, scoring Webb.
We've all been here before. The conference room, the speakerphone, the missing files. Not in the room, then you're not in the know. Well, this has been nice, but can we not? Microsoft Teams invites everyone you work with to work together. Be seen, be heard, be there when you're not. Share your files and your opinion, and maybe even a happy little fruit guy.
When you're ready to unleash the power of your team, open Teams.
Going into Saturday's action, Will McIntyre hadn't pitched in a college game. Now he's a veteran of two perfect innings and the start tonight working into the third inning.
Yeah, he's not a freshman anymore now, according to Dave Van Horn. So you get an outing under your belt and you're going to be called upon. But so far, I like his command. His presence on the mound is outstanding. Able to throw that breaking ball anytime he wants in any count.
Here's a video. Standing defensive catcher, batting 188. Dave Van Horn talked about Will McIntyre last week at his Swatters Club, trying to introduce the fans to a few players and pitchers that had not appeared in the game yet. And what he said about McIntyre is he throws the slowest of all of our right-handed pitchers, but everything sinks and dives. I think we've seen all of that.
Yeah, I think so, too. Just the movement on that pitch. The fastball, he tried to overthrow that one right there on 3-1, or to get the count to 3-1. But you're right, when he's on, he's going to get a lot of ground balls. And, again, with that big overhand curve, it's the pitch that really freezes hitters.
That one's hit a long ways. Back towards the hog pen, and that thing is long gone off the bat of Avidia, the catcher, his first of the season.
Boy, Avidia did not miss that hanging breaking ball. That was that. Got in the zone about belt high, and he hit that ball about 400 feet over the bullpen for Arkansas. Just a really nice compact swing by Avidia. Watch this extension. He hits that ball out in front of home plate, and he knew he got all of it. You can see the reaction of Webb in left field. He's just going to go, oh, I want to see how far that one goes.
And this was a guy who caught in the Cape Cod League last year with Orleans. That's a good throw. That man needs to be in the Cape
Cod
League. And I'll pose the question to Andy Stankiewicz today. You know, does he need to hit to get a chance at the next level? And he corrected me. He'll get a chance with his defensive abilities, but hitting a little more would certainly help.
Right. It really will. But those big league teams are looking for guys that can call a good game. Coach Stankiewicz said, you know, hey, we just sometimes just turn over the reins to him and let him call his own game. And that's what Arkansas does with Casey Opitz. You have to have a lot of confidence in your college catcher to be able to kind of get a feel for be able to call a ball game.
Goelko has a count of nothing and two.
So no, Matt Hobbs and Dave Van Horn want to see how McIntyre reacts after giving up the home run.
Gets strike three at the upper quadrant of the zone.
Got that curveball up in the zone just a bit, but he got the call. Nice bounce back by McIntyre.
Now batting, number 14, Channy Ortiz.
Back to the top of the lineup, and Channy Ortiz. Roller to Moore. He never looks out of position, or his hands never look slow.
He plays at one speed defensively, and that is quick. The thing I like about Robert Moore, how he fields the baseball, is it always seems like his feet are moving. You know,
yep.
He never gets caught back on his heels.
Two outs for Collado. Was 27 base hits. You see he's from San Salvador, El Salvador. A guy that did not play last year because of a broken arm. What were the terms we used to heard about him today? Raw, kind of a wild pony, just a guy with more games is just going to keep getting better and better.
The wild pony was Andy Stankiewicz's definition. I love that. He's just like, you know, he's just going to run crazy on the field, but he goes, I love his energy. He goes, you can corral that, but, you know, trying to light a fire under a player that doesn't have that motor is much more difficult.
There's no doubt. Hit 383 a couple of years ago in junior college baseball at South Mountain. See his numbers this year.
You know how the big league teams go to those Central American countries and get players or from the Dominican or Puerto Rico, but you think, how does a college kid get to the States and play college baseball?
He drives one into the gap in right center field. Franklin on the move, back near the warning track, and he will haul it in. And the inning ends, but the Lopes are on the board.
Avidia with a big swing for the Lopes in the third inning. He got all of that hanging breaking ball by McIntyre. A no-doubter out to left field. Hawks still lead 4-1.
We've all been here before. The conference room, the speakerphone, the missing files. Not in the room, then you're not in the know. Well, this has been nice, but can we not? Microsoft Teams invites everyone you work with to work together. Be seen, be heard, be there when you're not. Share your files and your opinion, and maybe even a happy little fruit guy. When you're ready to unleash the power of your team, open Teams.
Troy, take me through your keys.
Well, for the Lopes, you know, they've got to really heat up those bats. We talked about the team batting average, only .223. The bottom part of their order really scuffles. They need to transfer some of the big wins to this Arkansas game. You know, they beat Oklahoma State and Stanford, and for Arkansas, they need to have some good starting pitching. So far, so good for Will McIntyre. And again, just continue to kind of build on that momentum that they got from the walk-off Heston Kerstad home run.
That's my favorite angle. DVH not at all happy with strike one on Braden Webb, who singled last inning to kickstart that four-run, five-hit frame. Webb has quietly gone about his business to raise his average up to .340.
Yeah, very good at-bats by Webb. Love his quiet approach. Don't see him out there on the front foot too often.
Just keeps on hitting.
Yeah. Good two-strike swing right there by Braden Webb. Really stayed back, got jammed just a bit, but great result.
Next man in is Casey Opitz to face Cal Lambert. Opitz also had a single last inning. When you go from hitting .298 to .312 with one hit, that was a productive hit. It changes your whole baseball card, but it changes the whole outlook.
Well, anytime you hit over .300, you're a stud. So I think Casey's going to latch on that and hold on to it as long as he can. But just a guy that knows the strike zone very well. And I think that's the thing I've really liked about Casey Opitz. From both sides of the play, just very disciplined and not swinging to pitches that are not strikes. Easier said than done.
Funny thing is, have you been around many catchers in your day that were really good defensively behind the plate, that understood the strike zone, that didn't understand it when they were batting?
Not many.
Yeah.
And it translates very well.
There's something about that repetition, right? Seeing a number of pitches.
Well, you hope you understand the strike zone when you're catching those pitches. I played with a pretty decent catcher in the minor leagues my first year, and a guy I thought that was had that down to a science. Pudge Rodriguez, Hall of Famer. He was 17 when I played with him. He was already special.
I had him at the end of his career, and he was still special then. I got to call his 300th home run at Wrigley, and Casey Opitz will take ball four. Few guys have had an arm quite like Pudge.
Yeah, he started throwing the ball down to second base from his knees, and pitchers, even when guys would steal, would have to throw the pitch, and a lot of times they'll just kind of duck their head. They had to go down to one knee and tuck, and their back was only about maybe a foot off the ground, and the ball would clear their back by about 6 inches as he threw the ball down to second base. I mean, it was impressive. About a 1-8 pop time down to second. It was fun to play with him.
There's Nesbitt. Poked a single, a big chopper down the first baseline for an RBI hit last inning.
And Best, the first baseman, he is coming in. They think Nesbitt is going to bunt and was showing bunt. Took the strike. And sometimes you're wondering, if you're a fan of, okay, why are you going to bunt Jacob Nesbitt here? Well, first of all, you want to continue to get a lead. It's baseball. You never know what's going to happen. But also, you know, it's situational baseball. You need to be able to do it in midweek games because there might be a conference game or conference series that it might depend on that.
In the dirt, a ball and a strike.
We've seen Robert Moore pull that bat back and several different terms called it. Slug bunt, slash bunt. Real successful earlier on in the season.
Nesbitt squaring early. Remember, he had the squeeze bunt the other day that had some magic spin to it.
Hitting the dirt and then spun onto the grass.
Pitcher fell down. He got the base hit, the RBI, and everything flipped on that bunt. Well, for the fourth time, he'll square. At some point, do you just stop or do you just keep going? Just
nah,
keep squaring.
The purpose of that is son, you're going to get this bunt down one way or another. You're either going to get it down or you're going to have a conversation in the dugout.
Not so sure. If I was Lambert, I might not throw that big sweeping curve again. See if he wants to bunt that.
Yeah, it's a really difficult pitch to bunt because that's when you're going to have a high probability to pop up or just bunt right through. I'm not sure if Nesbitt actually knew which sign it was because he looked back more than once, and I think he's kind of happy that Lambert stepped off the back of the rubber right there and he got another flash of signs from head coach Dave Van Horn.
Next year you won't have to turn all the way around. Those right-handers won't. He did throw the curve, didn't he?
Yeah, he did.
Here, bunt this.
Left it outside. Now do you let him swing full
yes.
count? He got to.
Runners take late leads, and there they go. Nesbitt, oh, dear, that one got him right on the shoelaces.
He'll feel that for a while.
Both runners got great breaks, and Nesbitt got a pitch to swing at. Now he's wishing he had got the bunt down.
Yeah. I think that's a cutting fastball. Hit right on the arch of his foot. And I'm not sure how he doesn't just go all the way down to the ground.
I was thinking the same thing. They'd be scraping me up. I've said it before in my youth pitching days. There was nothing worse than taking a comebacker off your shoelaces where you were hoping the ball would miss you and it never did.
Right.
I would just take off running until I got to the outfield fence, and then I was only 200 feet away from where I wanted because eventually I was going down.
Right.
After starting the runners on the previous pitch, Lambert will break contact.
A lot of times the best place to throw this baseball is the runner going from first to second.
Runners go. They're getting used to this.
And Lambert goes with that fastball down and into right-handers a lot of times when he needs a strikeout. And with that three-quarter delivery, it's a kind of a sweeping fastball. Seems like it kind of comes across the strike zone at an angle.
Yeah, it does have a different look to it. Runners are tired of going. Webb nearly slipped. I don't think he was even going to try and go with the pitch, but he almost fell down. Another payoff pitch may eventually at some point possibly be on the way, maybe, to Nesbitt. I don't know if I'm banking on just yet. Both of these guys are wishing the bunt was just dropped down at the first pitch.
Yeah,
nine pitches later, they're still going.
If you're Lambert, you got to continue to pound the strike zone.
I think both of these runners are going to go. That one is grounded to third. And finally, Collado will make the tag on Webb. Here's the problem. Opitz was running and Webb wasn't.
Yeah.
That could have been a problem.
Yeah, Opitz is three-fourths of the way down the line. If Webb would have been running, I think he would have made it all the way to third base.
Would have been interesting,
yeah.
Right?
So you wonder if that's a missed sign right there.
had Nesbitt swung through it, there was going to be a problem. There was going to be two guys out there at second. Here's Robert Moore. He undressed Lambert with a smash that went through his legs into center for a base hit last inning. Moore never moved, and that ball was between his feet and everything else. 76 pitches for Lambert trying to get through this third inning. There hasn't been any activity whatsoever in the Lopes bullpen.
There's not even a body down there. This is all Cal Lambert.
I suppose to have activity, you'd have to have actually somebody in the bullpen. It's a lonesome place.
I tell you what, that's what a lot of head coaches want out of those midweek starters is, you know what, your job's going to go out there to chew up some innings, and we're just going to see how well you do. But we need you to get to X number of pitches or X through X innings.
With Robert Moore's base hit back in the second inning, there you see the pitching from McIntyre and what he's allowed compared to Lambert. Lambert got out of that first unscathed before that lengthy second, and this one shaping up to be a lengthy inning. Back to Moore, though, Troy, he's up to 15 RBIs. That's a big number.
That's really impressive. I think that's more than I had my whole freshman season. That's
little dribbler. Lambert. Oh, he did throw it. Not sure he ever got a clean handle on it.
You could just tell that was just squirted out and kind of Lambert had to go a long way for it, and he just could never get the good grip on it.
I thought he surrounded the baseball pretty well, but when he first pulled it out of the glove, I'm not sure if he had a clean handle on it, and then he just talked himself out of throwing it. And the Lopes are on the move now.
And they are loping down to the outfield, into the bullpen.
A parade of Lopes.
Going to give Robert Moore a swinging bunt hit on that. He'll take it.
Yes, sir.
Base is full of hogs.
Cole Austin, the batter. Bet he gets a curve. Nope. He locked up his catcher, though.
Boy, that was almost trouble right there.
He clearly was crossed up because after he threw that ball back, he felt like saying, my goodness, I was lucky I caught that. Had it been 90 instead of 86, I don't think he would have. Laced into the seats and landing back on the field of play.
Boy, that's one of those balls hit so hard you always hold your breath and make sure that everybody's okay.
Remember, it was Austin who took a chunk out of a fan just outside of the netting the other day, and it was scary, and yet the fan remained in the seat, and Austin went over and shook his hand. Well, a late strike call by Rick Allen.
A backdoor breaking ball right there by Lambert.
No place to put Cole Austin.
Almost have to count the three before you swing on that slow breaking ball.
You better not be in a hurry. Can you think about it? The two quick twitch guys in this lineup, Franklin and Martin?
Yeah.
Four strikeouts.
Yeah, really struggling.
Activity on the bases. Cole Austin has a chance with one swing to double up the Razorback run output. And yet he looks at strike three. That was well placed on the outside corner.
Yeah, it was a dandy. Great pitch. Just a really good location by Cal Lambert. With that fastball on the outside corner, I think Austin thought he was going to get something soft. Pop that fastball right in there.
So Franklin's seen this guy twice. I guess we'll find out if he has a little better look this time after a couple of Ks. Christian 10 for 17 over the last few games coming into tonight.
Franklin just giving up on that slow curveball. It's amazing what a great hitter I am up here in the booth, but when you see those pitches and it starts out over your head, you just give up on it.
Makes that fastball look faster than 87.
Looks like 100.
Do you have time if you recognize curve to almost reload when it's that slow?
Yeah, I think you really can.
Franklin got a piece to stay alive.
He took that one out of Vidya's glove.
I never heard the bat when in contact with it.
Almost behind him.
Boy, he didn't like that curveball. You get to the point now, this is his third at bat in three innings. You feel like you've seen a pretty good quantity of the breaking pitches.
Yeah, you feel like you should be making an adjustment at this point. This is going to be pitch number 90 for Lambert.
Razorbacks loaded the bases, and they left him loaded. Lambert gets the K to Austin, and Franklin to end the inning. Bit of a head scratch. Hawks still up 4-1.
Show me reality. TV.
Where my hobbits at? Play Lord of the Rings.
Play my Straight Out of the Shire playlist.
I want to see the king. Find LeBron.
Search more cartoons.
Play the last OG.
Take me to the streets. Play Sesame Street.
Me want more cookies.
Soft and cookie-like on the inside.
Find the things you love with the voice command. Introducing AT&T TV. With live TV and access to streaming apps, visit att.com/TV.
My name is Mo Hassan, and my nonprofit, Second Spoon. We're taking surplus foods and we're distributing them to the homeless in different communities. When I first got to college, I saw firsthand in the cafeterias just how much food was wasted. We need to find a way to repurpose these foods. Just seeing firsthand the homeless people's faces when we bring them food and positively affect them in that way is amazing. I just know it's more than football, and we have a platform, and I think we owe it to the community to use that platform for good.
Learn more at belk.com/projecthometown.
FX on Hulu, the pure premium brand. Free with every Hulu subscription. Over 40 original series. Over 1,400 episodes. The award-winning collection. And exclusive FX originals. Only on Hulu. FX on Hulu.
Georgia. Georgia. The whole day through. Just an old sweet song keeps Georgia on my mind.
Let's get to know the folks. Been around since 1949. I hear people talking about it being an online school, and I get it, but listen, the enrollment's 22,000 and growing as fast as the Arizona community.
Yeah, they talk about they're going to probably be over 25,000 next year, so a school that draws a lot of people to the Phoenix area.
Had a chance to get on campus last summer when it was smoking hot, just like I prefer it, and saw their stadium, and there's Andy Stankiewicz from his time at Arizona State, Grand Canyon, when they were part of the D2 ranks, taking them forward. As Cuba Best fouls one back and out of play. But the man who's put so much money into that school is Jerry Colangelo, the owner of the Arizona Diamondbacks back in the day and the Phoenix Suns. And they have a museum to Jerry on campus. Of course, he was part of the ownership of the Diamondbacks when they started play. There's a tapper to short, and Martin can't get there. And Best was just taking it easy up the line with that hammy, and yet he still reaches.
Yeah, he was just kind of trotting down the first base line. I think if Martin knew that, he probably could have made that play.
Casey approached it as a do-or-die effort. He probably could have just come flat-footed and maybe made the play and thrown out Bess.
Yeah, he said he was just literally trotting down the first base line. And boy, that's a tough feeling as an athlete. You want to go. Your motor is saying, yeah, just let it rip. But your body's going, let's just take it easy right there. Hamstrings are tough injuries to recover from.
Here is Smith, comebacker. McIntyre throws one to Martin, waits for it, and fires to first for the double play.
McIntyre threw a Martin. It looked like he threw him a balloon. He just floated out there to Casey. You can see Martin. He gets the baseman. He goes, man, I got to put a little mustard on this one to make this double play.
For a second, you thought that ball might end up in center field.
It's kind of like a palm ball grip as he tossed it to Casey Martin.
Two gone for Burton. But yeah, Grand Canyon is growing. It's a rather young campus. They have a great basketball program. Thunder Dan Marley, former Phoenix Sun, and Andy Stankiewicz, former big leaguer. And this is a team that, you know, last year they almost won their third straight conference title, 36 wins. They lost a couple of games to Sacramento State. Otherwise, they could have won that tournament and been in a regional.
Yeah, really quality program. And I tell you, hats off to Andy Stankiewicz of what he's building there in Phoenix.
Burton came up empty.
I've seen a couple pitchers with some dandy breaking balls. This is a good look at Coach Stankiewicz patrolling the third base coaching box.
Good baseball man. Those people who move to Arizona usually don't leave, Troy.
Yeah.
If you can stand the heat, you're going to be in for the long
you're
haul.
You're okay. Yeah. Definitely, I was talking to the SID for the team, and he's like, so where are you from? He said, Idaho. And I was like, really? How'd you get down there? And he said, well, I went on a recruiting trip, and it was minus 10 back home. And he goes, it was 75 in Phoenix. He goes, it didn't take me long to figure out where I wanted to go to school. Oh. Okay, I can understand that.
Winner, winner. McIntyre's given up a solo home run, trying to get through four innings, maintaining this lead. Gets the wave and a miss. Pretty good inning from Will McIntyre.
Nice job by McIntyre. His third strike out of the game. And you feel like the freshman is really going to be one of those midweek guys that Arkansas can lean on.
We've all been here before. The conference room, the speakerphone, the missing files. Not in the room, then you're not in the know. Well, this has been nice, but can we not? Microsoft Teams invites everyone you work with to work together. Be seen, be heard, be there when you're not. Share your files and your opinion, and maybe even a happy little fruit guy. When you're ready to unleash the power of your team, open Teams.
Anything with Hessen, I was just hoping he'd hit one into left center field gap. That was really the only gap that was open. They're playing deep and left, straight up. Center field was deep, maybe pull just a little bit. And obviously the right fielder was where he was. But two really good bats. Hessen laid off a pitch or two to kind of get an advantage count. Then he fouled off a pitch, 2-2, and then he finally got him a pitch. I'm thinking it was a changeup. I'm not sure. And that's the pitcher's best pitch. Lefties weren't even hitting 200 off of him this year so far. So that was a big swing.
Well, DVH might have been hoping that Kerstad hit one of the gap. A lot of us were thinking just hit one over the fence, and he just smoked another one. He's 2-for-2 with a walk.
Boy, that was a ball that Drew Smith out there at second base was just kind of got eaten up on, had a lot of top spin on it.
That's one where you protect your teeth.
Yeah. I'm just like, you know what? Sorry, Coach. Self-preservation out there at second.
Goodhart singled on a run back in the second. Boy, Lambert just keeps right on cruising, even though that pitch count is seven away from triple digits.
There is some activity in the Lopes bullpen, but Ken Lambert, you know, he's probably throwing about 50% off speed pitches.
Laced to right, down for a hit. Kerstad will get to second and hold as the throw comes in from Goelco. Talked about Kerstad's walk-off on Sunday. How about the Razorback softball team having not one but two walk-offs today?
Wow.
In 14 innings, they didn't score in the first six innings of either game. The first one they won on a walk-off hit by pitch. Game two, Kayla Green hit a home run for a 1-0 win.
Wow.
Ladies like the drama
they
a little
do.
Bit more than the guys. Maybe, just maybe. Pitching change here at Baum Walker. Razorbacks have a 4-1 lead in the bottom of the fourth inning.
We've all been here before. The conference room, the speakerphone, the missing files. Not in the room, then you're not in the know. Well, this has been nice, but can we not? Microsoft Teams invites everyone you work with to work together. Be seen, be heard, be there when you're not. Share your files and your opinion, and maybe even a happy little fruit guy. When you're ready to unleash the power of your team, open Teams.
Hawks have 10 hits, and there's nobody out in the bottom of the fourth inning. So Cal Lambert went as long as he could today, and the Lopes have gone to the bullpen. All the way from Canberra, Australia, Brody Cooper Vasilakis. That's a big name for the back of a jersey.
That is impressive. I'll tell you what, Vasilakis, really good ERA, only .93 in 9 2/3 innings. He does have 11 strikeouts, no walks. Well, that's incredible. Opponents only hitting .194 against Vasilakis. That's
just rolls off the tongue after you say it a few times.
Yeah, it's just as easy as pie.
Lambert gives up the 10 hits, 3 walks, 6 strikeouts. There were times with that slow curve he locked some people up as he's talking with Coach Stankiewicz, but it felt like either there were a couple of guys who really saw him well or those that didn't.
Right. And a feast or famine against Cal Lambert. But Vasilakis, he's not the only player from Australia. Cohen Wynn, another pitcher. Got guys from El Salvador, a pair from Australia. Nice international flavor on this ball club.
It's Casey Martin. He's happy that Lambert's gone. He struck out twice against him. Vasilakis, his father Theo, pitched for Australia. He is the Australian Capital Territory Commissioner. I have no idea what that means, but boy, it sounds good.
Sounds like he's the big dog somewhere, right?
He's the big wheel in Canberra.
Boy, dandy slider right there at 85.
Picked up a save earlier this year against Fordham. Now he's trying to get some outs.
That was filthy.
Every once in a while, you wonder if sports information directors put something in the media guide that's just false, just to see if anybody's paying attention. Martin fouls one back and out of play. You know, throw it in there to see if might just read it randomly.
Right.
Try this one on for size. Should see what the Hogs have done today. The game notes say Vasilakis became the youngest player ever in the Australian Baseball League when he debuted at 15.
Wow.
15?
Well, he's got a big arm, but yeah. You hear about guys.
Who was the Cincinnati Red pitcher that worked with Marty Brenneman that got in the game at the age of 15?
That's a piece of trivia I'm not sure about. Hogs with a pair of runners on the bases, no outs. 2-2 count for Martin.
Joe Nuxall. There's that funny spin again. Bobbled by Bass, and somehow Martin reaches. There's some weird voodoo going on up that line with some of these balls cued by the Hog hitters.
Watch this thing. It spins off the end of the bat. It looks like it's going to go foul. Then it goes fair. And watch it just spin right out of the glove of Best. Then he tries to stay on the bag to reach it. You see Casey having to kind of run around and jump over Best to get to first base.
That's easier said than done. Yeah. Big guy.
He takes up a lot of space, doesn't he? Again, the ball's just bouncing Arkansas's way today.
Joe Nuxall was 15 when he pitched for the Cincinnati Reds, so
wow.
I was on to something.
There you go. Thought you were slipping on me just there just a bit, but you're all over it, aren't you?
I'm a little elderly, but I'll get there. Here's Webb. He's got two hits and two at-bats.
Still no outs for the Lopes. They're going to play double play depth all around the infield. They're just trying to trade a run for a double play.
Good pitch.
That's a really tight breaking ball.
Hog at every base. Arkansas left the bases loaded in the third. They stranded a couple of runners in the second. This one's going to find its way well back and out of play. Webb has elevated his average all the way up to 354 with a pair of hits in the first few innings. Strike three. That was located as well as you can, a 94-mile-an-hour two-strike fastball.
That had some pop on it, didn't it? At the top of the strike zone, something you're going to definitely have to protect.
Yeah, it feels like that one's in, but
it was definitely right at the letters.
Yep. You see the reaction from Webb. That's a silent protest, a painful one. Opitz gets to turn around and bat left-handed. After walking and getting a base hit from the right side, you can see where this guy throwing 94 after those 69-mile-an-hour curves, this one feels like 100 at times.
Right. It looks like it's just exploding out of his hand.
Opitz said all he could do to get out of the way.
I thought they almost got a piece of his foot. The Lopes looking for that double play ball to get out of this inning unscathed.
Opitz drives one to center. Burton's going to have a play. Kerstad's going to tag. He's going to score. The Razorbacks have plated their fifth run.
What good quality at bat by Casey Opitz. He's got to put a charge into it somewhere. Good execution.
There's Jacob Nesbitt.
And if you're scoring at home, the ball that Casey Martin hit was considered an error, or ruled an error.
Should have been worth two.
Yeah.
Runners at the corners with two outs for Nesbitt. This Hog offense trying to get their sea legs, if you will. That 15-run, 18-hit performance on Saturday was a feel-good game. Then they had just three runs into the ninth on Sunday before Kerstad had that walk-off. Obviously, with conference play coming up this weekend, Troy, you know, no hitter wants to be second-guessing themselves or doubting themselves. And it felt like most of the conference played some lower-tier opponents last week. There were Ivy League teams. There was UMass, and then there was UMass Lowell. I don't know who played who, but they were all part of the competition. Ole Miss, they had 47 runs last weekend against Princeton.
Yeah.
47. That was like a school record.
Yeah, it's like a basketball score. Yeah, I think you do better by playing better competition. You feel like that it's going to carry over into conference play so much better than just, you know, really rolling over somebody and padding your stats.
Did you feel like if you didn't see top-end velocity for a week or so going into conference play when you knew it was coming, that it was tough to kind of calibrate again?
It really was. And so I think you've had a really good point right there, because as a hitter, you know, it's just a whole different level than when you play with those guys that are, you know, consistently in the low 80s with the fastball and then in the 70s with the off-speed stuff. And
it's a different gear.
You see somebody like Vasilakis come in, and that's SEC conference stuff. You know, that's a fastball that pops in the mid-90s, really sharp breaking ball, anywhere from 87 to 85 miles an hour. And he's the real deal on the mound for the Lopes right now.
Trying to strand a couple of Razorback runners. He'll do this, that. Nesbitt will K. The strikeout completed with a throw to first. I almost spoke too soon. The inning ends. Razorbacks have left eight runners through four innings. With the good news for the hometown team, it's a 5-1 Arkansas advantage.
My name is Mo Hassan, and my nonprofit, Second Spoon. We're taking surplus foods and we're distributing them to the homeless in different communities. When I first got to college, I saw firsthand in the cafeterias just how much food was wasted. We need to find a way to repurpose these foods. Just seeing firsthand the homeless people's faces when we bring them food and positively affect them in that way is amazing. I just know it's more than football, and we have a platform, and I think we owe it to the community to use that platform for good.
Learn more at belk.com/projecthometown.
I sing a song for the hustlers trading at the bus stop. Single mothers waiting on a check to come. Young teachers, student doctors, sons on the front line knowing they don't get to run. This goes out to the underdog. Keep on keeping at what you love.
Alexa, play new Alicia Keys on Amazon Music.
Everybody rise up. You gonna.
Lopes are not afraid to get after it, so to speak. Played Oklahoma State, Oregon. Of course, this series, they'll be in Baylor this weekend. Play Arizona State a couple of times. And they mentioned the number of games they play against Pac-12 competition. Stanford's been in that mix.
That's definitely going to help the RPI rating, no doubt about it. And again, it helps with recruiting too, so you can show up a recruit, because most of these coaches work on these schedules multiple years in advance. You know, the conference kind of schedules everything else up, and then after that, it's all up to the head coaches to kind of fill in the gaps.
If you talk to a college kid, and for the most part, school and a lot of things might be comparable. Grissom hacks at the first one. And Christian Franklin has a long run, but that's in the air a long time. That was an interesting jump catch, but one out. If you have a top-notch facility and you play an outstanding schedule, that's going to entice a lot of kids.
Right. And then it's the lows is going to be 70.
That's right.
You know, it's like you're never going to freeze. You're never going to have to, like, scrape snow off the field to practice.
No,
you know what? I think I'm going to go for that. How many times do you have to put the tarp on and off the field? Never.
That's right. It's not going to rain.
It's not going to rain.
Coeds don't need coats. They can wear dresses. You know, it's a good living out there in Zona. I moved to Arizona in 2000, first day of spring training, which would have been right around March 1st then, and came from the Midwest. I got there, and the field was as green as it could possibly be. It was 75 degrees. They were playing baseball March 1, and I thought, this.
It's paradise.
It's a pretty good place.
Yeah.
Aguilar singled.
My Arizona story is recruiting for work, and we went down to do some college recruiting in Arizona State and left Kansas City. It was sleeting rain, and then we got down there, and
everybody was wearing sweatshirts with their hoods pulled up, and it was 68 degrees. And we're just scratching our head. We were in golf shirts going, really? And they thought they were just freezing to death. It was comical.
Yeah, the plants were in danger at 68, probably. Aguilar singled in the second, but Grissom was out trying to go first to third to end the inning. This game's still within reason for Grand Canyon. Arkansas has 10 hits. They've left eight men on base, but only a 5-1 game.
Right. The last few innings, you felt like Arkansas really had things rolling. Left the bases loaded and then only pushed across one run last inning. They have not been able to kind of slam the door on the Lopes at this point.
Aguilar got a piece.
That got a piece of Opitz, and that doesn't feel too good.
Took a chunk out of Casey. Ouch.
Right off the bicep. It's another thing that you have to think about. Well, you see the numbers right there on McIntyre and the outstanding job he's done. Only basically one mistake pitch that got deposited into the stands. But other than that, it's been spot on. But you think about if you're Dave Van Horn, you had a five-game losing streak. Then you've won a couple. You'd really love to give Casey Opitz a day off, but you're like,
no doubt.
I really need to have him back there because he's the captain of this ship.
That pitch was left up, hit in the air right to Franklin. Set a couple of plays, two outs. Brings up Avidia, who homered well above the bullpen in left for the lone GCU run, and it was his first of the year.
If you're going to home run, if you're going to hit one, your first of the year, it's no doubter. It didn't just creep out.
He hit four a year ago, but batted less than 200, hit 198. His average has jumped up to 204. He was in the Cape with the Orleans Firebirds. You play in the Cape, you have a pretty good feel for what you do right and what you need to work on after playing with that level of competition.
Yeah, the competition, the wood bats, just all the way around, just the premier league of college baseball.
Play for Martin. It's up there a long time as well, the inning end. So the Lopes go in order in the top of the fifth. Halfway done tonight from Bob Walker. Razorbacks up four.
My name is Mo Hassan, and my nonprofit, Second Spoon. We're taking surplus foods, and we're distributing them to the homeless in different communities. When I first got to college, I saw firsthand in the cafeterias just how much food was wasted. We need to find a way to repurpose these foods. Just seeing firsthand the homeless people's faces when we bring them food and positively affect them in that way is amazing. I just know it's more than football, and we have a platform, and I think we owe it to the community to use that platform for good.
Learn more at belk.com/projecthometown.
Show me reality. TV.
Where my hobbits at? Play Lord of the Rings.
Play my Straight Out of the Shire playlist.
I want to see the king. Find LeBron.
Search more cartoons.
Play the last OG.
Take me to the streets. Play Sesame Street.
Me want more cookies.
Soft and cookie-like on the inside.
Find the things you love with the voice command. Introducing AT&T TV. With live TV and access to streaming apps, visit att.com/TV.
I'm going to make the Argentine chimichurri. Stay excited to see what they sell. So they give you like step-by-step ingredients. So I'm sure I can't mess this up. And that is the final dish.
Go to HelloFresh.com and use code YUM10 for 10 free meals, including free shipping.
There's something special about you. Something truly unique. You follow your own path.
Thank you.
recap tonight. The second inning, Troy, everything was bouncing the Hogs' way.
Boy, it really was. Nesbitt with a seeing eye double down the right field line. That scored Webb. Moore with a shot right back through the wickets of the pitcher Lambert, scoring Casey Opitz. And then Goodhart just kind of guides one out into left field, and that scores Cole Austin. And then the third inning, Avidia with just an absolute bomb. It almost cleared the seats out there in left field. That ball was hit a ton by the Lopes catcher.
Put GCU on the board. Arkansas got a run in the fourth, but Troy, they left the bases loaded in the third and stranded two runners in the fourth.
Yeah, those left on base and runners in scoring position, that's going to drive Coach Van Horn crazy.
He knows the schedule takes a turn for daunting soon. So Robert Moore leads off. Two singles, one he just blistered. Another one was a swinging bunt. Both count the same.
They'll take them both. There's always a lot of hard hit balls that get speared by a defender that those soft ones make up for.
You go 1-for-14 in the previous series, you can't wait to go 3-for-3 in the next game.
Oh.
In the fifth inning, he's 3-for-3.
Big at bat by Robert Moore.
Bob Moore, ball player.
Yep.
Hashtag
he,
it.
He is. I like it. Look at the balance that Moore has on this swing. And for a little guy, he only goes about 5'9", but boy, he really stays behind the baseball and generates a lot of power for that frame.
Here's Cole Austin. Austin's driven in a run, 0-for-2. Razorbacks trying to add to this 5-1 lead. Batting here in the bottom of the fifth. Vasilakis drops in a strike.
Really tying up Cole Austin with that breaking ball.
There's young Robert Moore, and we joked about all of his nicknames the other day, how he said he had 15, and he ran them all off for us. 12-year-old, teacup, pipsqueak, minor, the baby.
He answers. I like the teacup.
I like pipsqueak. Yeah. I think that's a fun one. Teacup's an interesting one. He didn't seem too affected by 12-year-old.
Yeah. Before the season started, Kerstad was going around the locker room and interviewing players, and he said, "Do you have a driver's license yet?" And he goes, "Yeah, I just got it last year." And he said, he goes, I drive over to Fayetteville High and hang out with kids my own age.
Cole Austin down on strikes. You know, only Dave's dry sense of humor could he say, yeah, he has about 15 nicknames. And he's pretty close, about 7 or 8.
Yeah, it's up there.
Tell you, one guy who's thrilled to see Lambert gone is Christian Franklin. He struck out all three times against him. Gets a hard-throwing righty instead.
And more his speed, isn't it? Sometimes those soft lefties give certain players fits, and I know I never liked him.
He felt like the guy that went to the carnival, and he just kept throwing the baseballs into the bowling pins and just couldn't knock them down, and he just kept getting more angry, spending more money. It wasn't happening.
A pretty good-looking pitch right there by Vasilakis. Maybe up in the zone just a hair. And see what Christian Franklin did a week ago, and he was really carried that team offensively.
Doesn't it show you how yesterday's hero is not, or today's struggling player is the guy who's going to hit next? Franklin was 10 for 17, and he's 0 for 3, 3 Ks.
Yeah.
Robert Moore was 1 for 14. He's 3 for 3.
That's when you have to have your opponents, or not your opponents, your teammates pick you up. It's a great thing about baseball. You just hope that hitting gets contagious up and down the order.
3-0 pitch is not close. Razorbacks have two more runners on base. They have had a village on over the course of these first five innings. Well, Vasilakis, after walking Franklin, gets to deal with a man who is 2-for-2, has 27 hits on the year in Heston Kerstad.
I think the baseball looks like a pumpkin to Kerstad at this point.
And in the words of Andy Stankiewicz, who spent several years in the major leagues, that Heston guy looks like he's a big leaguer, I think was what he said.
Yep. Because I don't know what we're going to do against him. See that big high leg kick by Kerstad. Timing mechanism.
His average with a couple of hits is at 443. Might take half of that.
Yeah.
At some point.
That's just incredible. 6 home runs, 19 RBIs. Scored 17 runs and on those 27 hits.
It's pretty amazing.
That is getting it done.
Smoked again. A third hit from Heston Kerstad. He's going to get another RBI, and he just keeps on hitting.
Well, if we get to see that again, that is not a bad pitch by Vasilakis. I mean, that ball is a breaking ball down in. Watch the location of that pitch. He just hits that one right off his front shin and just ropes one past Best, the first baseman.
They're going to have to print more money when he gets to the big leagues.
Yes.
I'm not sure how much it would cost to buy all of Amarillo, Texas. He might get to find out.
He's going
to
try.
Here's Matt Goodhart. He's been on base all three times. So Kerstad and Goodhart have been on all 7 times they've come to the plate. Razorbacks have done this without a home run tonight. On a winless night, for the most part, 6 runs on 12 hits. Everything has stayed in the park. Goodhart was swinging a wood bat, it would have been 2 pieces.
That was a great pitch. That was right off his thumbs.
He swung so it didn't hit him in the chest, I think. Gotta see that one again.
Self-defense.
See if the Lopes can get 2. There's 1. Double play. Razorbacks, though, add a run. Another base hit from Heston Kerstad. It's a 6-1 Hogs lead through 5 innings.
Who do you think of when I say hero? Is it someone in a cape, or is it someone you know? In SEC country, being a hero means tutoring a struggling student, feeding hungry neighbors in your community, or showing up at a hospital to make a child's day a little brighter. Heroes are all around us, and Belk wants to celebrate them with what we're calling Project Hometown Heroes. We'll show you everyday heroes that are strengthening the communities around the SEC. Now, who do you think of when I say hero? Learn more at belk.com/projecthometown.
Show me reality. TV.
Where my hobbits at? Play Lord of the Rings.
Play my Straight Out of the Shire playlist.
I want to see the king. Find LeBron.
Search more cartoons.
Play the last OG.
Take me to the streets. Play Sesame Street.
Me want more cookies.
Soft and cookie-like on the inside.
Find the things you love with the voice command. Introducing AT&T TV. With live TV and access to streaming apps, visit att.com/TV.
There are people from all over the region that are here in Nashville. Let's put on a show, Joe.
Because they ain't never seen me fall under pressure. They ain't never, ever seen me fall, nah, never. Always keep one up on them because I'm too clever.
We got to play inspired.
Yeah, where you been? Where you been? When it was time to do some work and put it in. Never lose, I go overtime on them. Stay in that gym, let's get it.
Because I've been on the road, they on the road.
Georgia,
Georgia, the whole day through. Just an old sweet song keeps Georgia on my mind.
Take a look at the team comparison coming into tonight's action. This is a good Grand Canyon program, but they, Troy, have not hit the baseball to the level they would like to this point. And that Razorback 307 number, to me, that's even a little bit deceiving because it doesn't feel like they've been clicking on all cylinders.
You're exactly right. And you know, you feel like Arkansas's lineup has room to improve. And you feel like Grand Canyon, the top of the order has been pretty solid. It's the bottom, that bottom third. And they've really scuffled, and Andy Stankiewicz is just trying to figure out how to settle those guys down. So now you know it's a long season. Baseball's a tough game. You can't really ride on what you're doing right now. You're just going to have to battle your way through it.
9-1-2 do up this inning. Here is Gawelko. Struck out looking in the third inning. What have you seen from Will McIntyre through five now plus innings?
Well, just the ability to really pound that strike zone. He's been able to really feel that breaking ball down and away from hitters. Like I said, the only pitch he made the mistake on was the home run by Avidia. You can see how economical he's been in each inning. If you're Dave Van Horn, you got to love that having.
Especially midweek.
Yeah, midweek, going to have a couple games in midweek. Good look at Dave Van Horn and Matt Hobbs right there. Pitching coach, outstanding pitching coach Arkansas has.
Ball and two strikes. Poked out towards right. Kerstad will amble over. Put it away. Six in a row, set down by McIntyre, and in that stretch he's recorded seven outs. Back to the top of the lineup. Channy Ortiz.
Just kind of made it look easy out there, hadn't he?
He did that the other day in relief, and I think that's probably why he got this starting
right.
Assignment.
It's like, wow. Where'd you come from? Ortiz kind of gave up on that fastball, had a little run to it. I think he thought it was going to fade outside the zone. See, Opitz going with the touches instead of the signs and the numbers. Sometimes you have different pitchers that can't see very well at night.
McIntyre knocks it down. Here comes Martin. Gets with a bare hand. Doesn't have a play. Lopes are probably saying if we get six more of those, we'll equal what the Razorbacks have tonight.
Yeah. Finally, a ball that bounces the Lopes way. Ball hit pretty sharply. McIntyre almost speared that thing, and for a second, you thought Martin was going to get that ball. You see, the hitter, Ortiz, had to kind of kick it into another gear when he saw Martin getting closing in on that baseball.
He has one gear. Here's Collado. He singled and flied out to center.
Collado, by far the Lopes' most consistent hitter. You see those gaudy numbers hitting 370.
He had back-to-back three-hit games against Oklahoma State. That's a I-can-play-at-this-level day. That's a long run for Webb on the chalk. Make the catch for out number two. They have hit some big-time pop-ups and fly balls tonight. And there's two gone for Cuba Bess. Got an infield base hit in the fourth when he hit a dribbler that Martin could not handle. You know, you hear a name like Cuba and you think there's got to be a story to it, right?
Sure.
Well, his father decided to name his son Cuba after he watched the movie Boys in the Hood. Cuba Gooding Jr., but wasn't that Cuba? Didn't he go by Cuba instead of Cuba?
I think so.
All right. Well, nonetheless, Boys in the Hood is the inspiration for this guy's first name. Boys with a Z, too, Troy.
Oh, yeah.
All right. Hang with me.
Some swag with those boys, right?
Cuba, though, Colorado native, was drafted by the Rockies out of high school late in the draft.
Looks like a guy that you definitely want to keep the ball away from. Looks like he could hurt you middle to end.
Smoked into right of base hit. So Bess, a preseason All-American after hitting 341 a year ago with the 11 home runs. It's 2-for-3.
Well, you really like his smooth left-handed swing. Really scorched that one. He almost got a piece of Ortiz running at first base. I think he had to hop that baseball. And again, if that ball hits him, he's out. The base runner is out with a batted ball.
Best would have been given a hit, but nonetheless, the inning would have been over. Here's Drew Smith, Nebraska native. We talked a lot about the Lopes and some junior college prospects, including Smith. So last year, he was the National D2 Junior College Player of the Year at Northeast Community College in Norfolk, Nebraska. I'm from that edge of the country, and I've never been to Norfolk, Nebraska. However, Drew Smith hit 465.
Oof.
He was 86 for 185, almost 500, hit 18 homers, 69 RBIs. His on-base percentage was well over 500. His slugging percentage just under 900.
I just don't know why you just would continue to pitch to him.
I don't know how many people have an OPS of almost 1,500.
Well, who is the best? I think Babe Ruth, and this is like 1,100. Granted, that's over a whole career.
'86 for 165.
That's just crazy.
If they put it on a tee and let you go out there with nine fielders, you might not get that many hits. Started at Creighton, had a couple of years, and his 2 years then at the junior college ranks had 148 hits. This guy can hit, can't he? That's sharply hit, but Nesbitt makes the play, and that will save a run to end the inning. So the Lopes get a couple of singles, strand a pair of runners. 5.5 complete. Will McIntyre's looking good.
My name is Mo Hassan, and my nonprofit, Second Spoon. We're taking surplus foods and we're distributing them to the homeless in different communities. When I first got to college, I saw firsthand in the cafeterias just how much food was wasted. We need to find a way to repurpose these foods. Just seeing firsthand the homeless people's faces when we bring them food and positively affect them in that way is amazing. I just know it's more than football, and we have a platform, and I think we owe it to the community to use that platform for good.
Learn more at bulk.com/projecthometown.
Shouldn't you pay less when you use less data? Now you can, because Xfinity Mobile gives you more flexible data. You can choose to share data between lines, mix with unlimited, or switch it up at any time. All on the most reliable wireless network, which means you can save money without compromising on coverage. Get more flexible data, the most reliable network, and more savings. Plus, get $300 off when you buy a new Samsung Galaxy S20 Ultra. That's simple, easy, awesome. Call, click, or visit a store today.
HelloFresh. I can always count on you.
So my days can get pretty jam-packed, whether I have a 14-hour day on set or a writing session. It's so important for me that I take the best care of myself that I can. And that's why HelloFresh is important to me, because what I put in my body determines what I get out of it. These are all fresh ingredients. They're delicious, and they make me feel incredibly healthy. HelloFresh is my secret tool to feeling my best and doing my absolute best.
Go to HelloFresh.com and use code YUM10 for 10 free meals, including free shipping.
What is Steph's? 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 What is Steph's?
as good as anybody in the country at throwing out would-be base stealers at 50%. Now, Troy, over this five-game losing streak, the Hogs weren't able to run. They were always trailing.
Right.
The question is now, with a five-run lead, whether they might test this young man should they get an opportunity.
I think if they're going to be selective, maybe who's on base. But again, a five-run lead is never safe. So if you got a ballpark like Baum Walker, more prone to give up home runs.
There's Casey Martin, who's 0-3. And you've talked a lot about the fact that stealing bases comes down to math a lot of times. Release and pop times for the pitcher and catcher. I'm curious if the competitor in you ever says, all right, this guy's supposed to be pretty good. Let's find out.
I think so. I think there's always a little bit of that, especially maybe a guy like Martin. If he gets on first base, you might see Van Horn give him the green light. There's something about speed when it gets on the bases. It just changes the whole dynamic of an inning. That pitcher's attention really focuses on that runner at first base. Sure would love to see Casey hit one, maybe through that first and second base hole. Really try to stay on a pitch.
It felt like the game against Illinois State and that first game against South Alabama when the team lost both, that maybe he had found it. A little bit jumpy maybe at times in these last few games.
Sometimes those old habits kind of rear their ugly head.
They're habits for a reason, because you're trying to break them.
That is true. When you're used to pulling the baseball and teams try to throw you away, it's hard to make that adjustment trying to hit that ball to right center field.
Three strikeouts for Martin tonight. One gone, sixth inning. Vasilakis has shown some pretty good stuff.
Well, watch the depth of this breaking ball. It just drops off the table. I'm telling you, he's got some dandy stuff.
He does.
Sharp, sharp slider. That fastball we've seen hit 94. Almost a little surprised that Coach Stankiewicz didn't save him for tomorrow's game. Not that this game is over, but and he's got some shutdown stuff.
No, he does. I think part of what you like is he's such a contrast to Lambert, the left-handed starter, with that big slow breaking ball.
Well, Lev, watch how light Braden Webb's top hand is. I mean, really loose grip on that bat, and I think you get a lot more bat speed that way. Some of you see guys that are really get the white knuckle that bat, kind of, you know, the death grip on it. I feel like I always felt like I had more bat speed the looser I could hold that bat. And watch when he comes set how loose the top hand is.
It's funny you say that. I think back to the guy I was around every day for 7 years. The one I thought had the best bat speed that I was with was Lance Berkman, and I swear once a week he would throw that thing like a javelin down each line, like 110 feet. The bat would slip out of his hands on that snap.
It really would, and I tell you, it's an instinct thing that when you make contact that your grip is going to tighten up. But every so often when you don't make contact, that's when that bat goes flying. Boy, I saw those great hitters. Right, Carew, George Brett back in the day with real loose hands.
Felt like Carew, you could walk up there and just knock it away easily.
Just blow on it and fall out of his hands.
2-2 to Braden Webb, who's trying to get his third hit in his fourth at bat. Didn't miss by much.
Boy, a lot of pop 95 with that fastball.
Vasilakis struck out Webb looking in a pitch that he did not care for at all in the fourth inning.
Seems like that slider has been his out pitch.
Threw it on the 3-2.
A lot of confidence in that pitch.
Thank you. Hawks have had a hit in every inning. Will this one find its way out of play? It will. Tomorrow, afternoon game at 3 Central. Before the Hogs head to Starkville, and then these Lopes go to Waco. Would you rather go to Starkville or Waco if you had a chance to vacation?
Vacation?
Yep, vacation. By yourself.
I'm thinking I'm going to Waco.
Get a barn dominium in Waco. You would be good to go. I think I'd take that too. That one fouled away.
Good battle right here between Cooper Vasilakis and Braden Webb. So he's throwing the fastball. He's throwing the breaking ball. What do you come back with right here? You can throw him another breaking ball.
I do too. First, you got to check the wristband.
Going with the touches.
Came back with a fastball and he missed. Maybe he should have thrown the breaking ball. Webb aboard with one gone. He's approaching 50 as Vasilakis in relief. Casey Opitz had a sacrifice fly back in the fourth inning. He singled and walked as well, so officially he's one for one. This is fourth plate appearance. Feel like there's a Razorback due for a home run here pretty quick. Vasilakis has had really good stuff, but hard to keep this team in the yard when the wind's not blowing in.
When you got a guy on the mound that's got some velocity in that fastball.
There's some giddy up.
Yeah, you're right. This is a very calm night here at Baumwalker Stadium. Not much breeze at all.
It's like a comet. Every 30 or 40 years,
you get one of those.
You get a night where there's no wind. Opitz was thinking along those lines, but he got under that. And that's a play for Burton. Two gone.
Now batting third base, number 5, Jacob Nesbitt.
Pretty good strikes to balls ratio for Brody Cooper Vasilakis. Gave up the one run, and that came an inning ago when Kerstad singled in Robert Moore. There's that breaking ball.
I mean, that's a really nice, tight, late breaking slider. Because as a hitter, you see that pitch and you think, okay, that's a fastball right over the middle of the plate. That three quarters of the way to the plate, that thing just knifes away from you.
Yeah, it comes out of that hand looking fastball, that's for sure. We have a perfect 6-for-6 on stolen bases. Draws a throw over at first. Nesbitt waiting. Good low strike, 93 on the gun.
Well, that's really tough as a pitcher to be able to hold that baseball. Not only are you freezing the runner at first base, but you're also freezing that hitter just a little bit, and then you pound one right at the knees.
Felt like Jacob was really close to maybe requesting time and stepping out. Instead, he got 93 painted. Twelve hits tonight for the Hogs. They had a four-run second inning. Single runs in the fourth and fifth.
Vasilakis and his catcher Avidia trying to get on the same page.
And that will end the inning. First frame, the Razorbacks do not get a hit. They leave a runner. Six complete. Fun at the old ballpark. Hogs up 6-1.
We've all been here before. The conference room, the speakerphone, the missing files. Not in the room, then you're not in the know. Well, this has been nice, but can we not? Microsoft Teams invites everyone you work with to work together. Be seen, be heard, be there when you're not. Share your files and your opinion, and maybe even a happy little fruit guy. When you're ready to unleash the power of your team, open Teams.
Let's give you some news and notes around the world of college baseball. Vanderbilt went out to L.A., played UCLA and USC, and they didn't have a great time, but UCLA got that win 3-2. How about this midweek matchup? But it factors in because Mississippi State, Arkansas's opponent this weekend in Starkville, they're playing two games against second-ranked Texas Tech.
Yeah, that's really tough scheduling. And right before conference play, you could see maybe a little earlier in the season, but, man, that you're talking about getting really teed up this week. That's tough.
We're going to have to check the scoreboard a little bit later on. Florida, a unanimous number one, is at home against Florida State, so that could be a fun matchup. And here comes Caden Monk on in relief in this seventh inning.
I think they're being a little liberal with Caden Monk's weight. I'm not sure he goes 170. We'll give it to him. I like how Dave Van Horn talks about Caden Monk. He said, you know, in scrimmages last year, he threw everything, all arms and knees and elbows. He goes, we couldn't hit him, but he couldn't throw strikes. He said this year, does the same thing. He said, we can't hit him, and he's throwing strikes. So, loves the stuff out of this left-hander.
Brock Burton is the hitter. Pretty strong outing, though, for Will McIntyre. He hadn't pitched in a game until Saturday, and now he's gone eight innings and given up a total of one run.
Yeah, he'll get some more opportunities on midweek ball games. I'll tell you that for sure.
You feel like that with the performance last weekend that Caleb Bolton will get a few more opportunities to be in that rotation somewhere, somehow, and McIntyre might get his chance too.
Yeah, Bolden, you feel like that fastball is coming back. Dandy fastball right there by Caden Monk, painted the inside corner. But, yeah, there's a good look at McIntyre and what he did on the bump tonight.
No walks.
Outstanding. Great control. The no walks is what's really going to get the coach's attention.
See him next to Big ZV Vermillion. How about his performance on Sunday?
Boy, he was just snapping off that breaking ball, wasn't he?
Three innings, no hits, no runs, no walks, and he struck out six, and he got the win. Here's Dominic Grissom. See his four home runs for the team's 14. Started with the San Francisco Dons a couple of years ago and then went to Phoenix College before coming to GCU. Grissom out of El Paso. Had a big home run earlier this year against Oklahoma State. Gave GCU the victory in the series win. Tomahawks won. That'll get by Nesbitt. Nesbitt so good over there at third base. That ball was tattooed, and Grissom has his second hit in three at-bats.
Yeah, that ball was really scorched past Nesbitt. Really no chance for Jacob over there. Tell you what, good hitters just find the way to make solid contact.
A lot more often than not. I got a kick out of the quote from Mark Calvey the other day after the game, Troy, talking about pitching to Kerstad in the ninth inning with a runner at first base, and he said we had a 55% chance of getting him out.
55.
Meaning, you know, he was hitting about 450 at
yeah.
the time. So a 45% chance he'd get a base hit, 55% we'd get him out, and we lost.
That's classic.
That was a great quote. Here's Aguilar, left on left. Based on that math, Arkansas should have about an 82% chance of retiring Aguilar.
There you go. Man, some quick math in the head. I'm impressed. Arkansas looking for a ground ball.
There are a combined 20 hits in this game. You want to take a guess quickly off the top of your head without processing or thinking how many have been for extra bases?
I'm going to say one. No, one.
One.
One, the home run.
All 12 of Arkansas's hits have been singles. Seven of the eight for the Lopes, singles.
Well, you think about the Lopes, they just haven't been able to string their hits together. Eight hits, just one run in the big swing. Another good fastball by Caden Monk.
Boy, I like this lefty.
Boy, a dandy breaking ball right there.
There's been one extra base hit in this entire game, Troy. Here it is.
Well, it was a loud one, wasn't it? Ball was absolutely tattooed. Landed about three-fourths of the way up into the seats by Avidia. Show some power.
Popped a short his last time in. Another hard hit, this time Nesbitt down to a knee. And Austin kept his foot on the bag, so Lopes get a hit, they leave a man. We're going to stretch him out from Bob Walker. Hawks up five.
Who do you think of when I say hero? Is it someone in a cape, or is it someone you know? In SEC country, being a hero means tutoring a struggling student, feeding hungry neighbors in your community, or showing up at a hospital to make a child's day a little brighter. Heroes are all around us, and Belk wants to celebrate them with what we're calling Project Hometown Heroes. We'll show you everyday heroes that are strengthening the communities around the SEC. Now, who do you think of when I say hero? Learn more at belk.com/projecthometown.
Show me reality TV.
Where my hobbits at? Play Lord of the Rings.
Play my Straight Out of the Shire playlist.
I want to see the king. Find LeBron.
Search more cartoons.
Play the last OG.
Take me to the streets. Play Sesame Street.
Me want more cookies.
Soft and cookie-like on the inside.
Find the things you love with the voice command. Introducing AT&T TV. With live TV and access to streaming apps, visit att.com/TV.
We're going to get cooking these chicken cutlets, and we're going to bring you right in with us. These come perfectly portioned. You can't mess up.
They're
it's
great.
So nice.
This is absolutely one of my favorite things because it gets me out of my box to try things that I maybe wouldn't have tried. And guess what? I always love it, even the vegetables.
Go to HelloFresh.com and use code YUM10 for 10 free meals, including free shipping.
Georgia, Georgia, the whole day through, just an old sweet song keeps Georgia on my mind.
We're talking milestones for DBH. Tonight could be number 699, and the big question is, do we get cake for number 700?
Well, we should. Tell you what, it's 700, that's a big number. He just wants to get this team rolling. See all those big events so far in his career. Other thing you have to remember too is coached Nebraska and took them to two College World Series appearances. So that's just at Arkansas.
Robert Moore has three hits and three at-bats. Does he have a fourth? I think he might. He's going to be out by a step. Vasilakis threw one of those 94-mile-an-hour heaters to first.
Well, you thought he was almost there, and I tell you what, that's the feeling as a base runner. You think you're going to make it, and you get about that last two steps, and you go, I've got it, I've got it. Oh, man. Bang, bang, and you're out.
Watch him clap his hands at the end. He knows he's out.
Like,
watch this.
Oh, darn. He just didn't get it pushed up the line.
Here's Colt Austin. Chopper right to first. Bessa's got it. Could have taken that himself, but he'll flip with that bad hammy.
Yeah, he's got a bad wheel over there. He's like, okay. Anytime I can get some assistance, I'll take it.
He's the guy who's calling for an Uber when he's a block from the hotel.
Exactly.
Back to the top of the lineup for Franklin, who's walked and struck out three times.
The scorebook goes 1-3 for Moore, 3-1 for Austin. You're just playing catch over there.
Yeah, the reciprocal. Comeback. That's a quick inning. There's another one of those 1-3s. Hawks go in order. For the first time tonight, we go to the eighth inning. Razorbacks looking for a win.
We've all been here before. The conference room, the speakerphone, the missing files. Not in the room, then you're not in the know. Well, this has been nice, but can we not? Microsoft Teams invites everyone you work with to work together. Be seen, be heard, be there when you're not. Share your files and your opinion, and maybe even a happy little fruit guy. When you're ready to unleash the power of your team, open Teams.
Here's what the Lopes have on tap. Now they go to Baylor this weekend. How about the game on March 17th?
How cool is that? It's a... April Fool on St. Patty's Day. Maybe it's not really going to happen. No, but it is.
Get to play the Diamondbacks.
That is real cool.
Torrey Lovullo, the manager of Arizona, the D-backs, and Andy Stankiewicz, a former D-back, good friends. And that'll be a lot of fun for these guys. You talk about a week where you get to come on the road, experience the SEC, then you get to experience the Big 12, then you go back and play a big league team.
That's full circle, but that's impressive.
So at the end of that sequence, they're going to play UTRGV. That's a good team in this WAC, and it is a strange conference when you talk about geography. This one is sent to the gap. Franklin on the move, and he'll get there.
Wow, what a great catch by Christian Franklin. Arkansas fans have been spoiled by some great center fielders as of late. Andrew Benintendi, Dominic Fletcher. But, wow, Christian Franklin, look at the ground he covers out there in the outfield. That was a dandy play.
That had a Dominic Fletcher-type feel to it. As Ortiz bats. Think about the WAC, though, Troy. This is a conference that features everything from Seattle to the Texas-Mexico border.
That travel budget's going to have to be healthy, isn't it?
This year alone, the Lopes are going to travel about 12,000 miles.
You hope you can get to keep your freaking flyer miles. Wow.
That's a lot of traveling. Not sure if they're going to be real thrilled about going to Seattle if they get that as a road trip this year.
I'll tell you.
Then they do in April. Ooh.
Maybe it'll warm up enough to get rid of that virus.
I don't know. Ortiz has one of the eight base hits, and he's facing Monk. Caden in his second inning in relief of Will McIntyre, who authored six strong innings tonight. Play for Kerstad. And Heston will put it away. Glenn Kerstedt has those sunglasses on his hat in case he thought there were three outs, too.
No, he was running that baseball in. I think Moore looks up at him and goes, hey, old-timer, you got to remember. Look at him. He's pointing to him right now. He goes, there's two outs. Two.
I like it. He's got the sunglasses on, and he thinks there's three outs.
Yeah, Moore was having fun with him right there. He was like, you got to lock into what's happening out here.
He had me ready to throw it to break. I'm like, well, two, three, close enough. Here's Collado. Well, it took just one more pitch to get that third out, unless Austin can't scoop it. How about Austin saving Casey Martin?
What a pick right there by Cole Austin. Arkansas takes that one to the bottom of the eighth. They lead 6-1.
Who do you think of when I say hero? Is it someone in a cape? Or is it someone you know? In SEC country, being a hero means tutoring a struggling student, feeding hungry neighbors in your community, or showing up at a hospital to make a child's day a little brighter. Heroes are all around us, and Belk wants to celebrate them with what we're calling Project Hometown Heroes. We'll show you everyday heroes that are strengthening the communities around the SEC. Now, who do you think of when I say hero? Learn more at belk.com/projecthometown.
Show me reality. TV.
Where my hobbits at? Play Lord of the Rings.
Play my Straight Out of the Shire playlist.
I want to see the king. Find LeBron.
Search more cartoons.
Play the last OG.
Take me to the streets. Play Sesame Street.
Me want more cookies.
Soft and cookie-like on the inside.
Find the things you love with the voice command. Introducing AT&T TV. With live TV and access to streaming apps, visit att.com/TV.
FX on Hulu, the pure premium brand. Free with every Hulu subscription. Over 40 original series. Over 1,400 episodes. The award-winning collection. And exclusive FX originals. Only on Hulu. FX on Hulu.
Alabama's good, though.
Yeah, I mean, you know, if you like good teams.
What's your problem with good teams?
Well, good's kind of boring. You know me, I'm a bad boy.
What are you talking about?
Yeah, like I used to talk during church.
Oh, like in front of the congregation?
No, like during the sermon. You know, like whispering to my brother until your dad gives you that look, you know?
Mama gave me that look, too. That is bad.
I'm telling you, I'm bad to the bone.
You know, Florida's good, though.
It gets real soon in the SEC. How about this slate of games? And really every series is pretty impressive. But that one up on top with the unanimous number one Gators hosting number two Georgia.
Wow, that Georgia's got Emerson Hancock, who could be the top pick in the draft. He's electric. And then, boy, Asa Lacy with A&M, the one at number 14.
There's another.
Auburn.
LSU and Ole Miss don't care much for each other. And the Hawks facing Mississippi State. The Bulldogs playing in Biloxi, Mississippi tonight. I'm assuming that's the stadium of the AA team, the Shuckers. They lead Texas Tech 6-2 late. Uh-oh.
That's not good.
Did that get him on the hand and not the wrist? That is not good at all. Kerstedt was riding a 3-for-3 night with a walk, and he's on base for the fifth time, and there are so many bones in that hand that let's hope that that didn't get anything important.
Just a fastball riding up and in. A lot of times you see those hitters try to roll that shoulder to protect those hands.
Wasn't much time
there. No, there really wasn't. That's about a 93-mile-an-hour fastball. Casey Martin broke that hamate bone and had to have surgery in the fall. And I've asked him. He said, it's still a little sore. And I asked him, I go, hey, I see you choking up off the bat. And he goes, yeah, the knob hurts my hand.
That's concerning in and of itself, but Heston going to be lifted for Washington Jr. He's still looking at that, and he's showing DVH in the dugout where it got him. And, you know, the obvious question is, does it hurt? And the obvious answer is yes.
Yeah. I wouldn't be surprised if he's going to go get an X-ray here pretty quick.
That turned a pretty interesting night for the Razorback fans into one with a little bit of –
A little drama. Dread. Yeah, I'm telling you.
Here's Goodhart. Curtis will no doubt stay in to play in the outfield. Razorbacks have 12 hits tonight. Every single one of them, all 12 as it is, have been singles. Vasilakis up over 60 in his pitch count of relief. He came into the game back in the fourth inning when there was a couple of runners on and nobody out.
Okay, here's something for you, Brett. Talk about everything's been singles. Including a sacrifice fly by Casey Opitz. How many fly balls have the Razorbacks hit today in this ballgame?
I feel like there's many.
Two. Both by Casey Opitz. He sack flied in the fourth.
Pretty deep flies last time.
Yep, and he had a deep fly ball to center field in the sixth. Every other hit has either been a hit, a strikeout, or something on the ground. Wow. That's a team not really driving the baseball to the gaps, is it?
No, on another night, some of those balls that found their way between infielders may have resulted in outs. We have a balk. We did.
I think they said that Vasilakis didn't step toward first base. He just kind of spun his feet and hopped as he made the throw. See if there's a step.
No, that knee flinch.
Oh, yeah, the little knee. That front knee is what base stealers key off of, and he kind of – Blaine Knight was really good at that. He would kind of buckle that knee and then start that move to first base. Every once in a blue moon, he'd get called for a buck. Not very often.
Like a newborn colt, there was a little bit of a wobble there before
yeah.
he made the maneuver.
Pitch really came out of the back of Vasilakis' hand. Just didn't get on top of that breaking ball. Probably try to overthrow it on 0-2.
Nobody out this inning. Razorbacks looking to add on. Goodhart will go down on strikes.
One other thing for fans have been able to see here is this, about an hour before the game started, there's a military cargo plane that's just been looping over the field and taking practice runs over Drake Field. And I tell you, it's getting closer and closer to flying over the stadium. There's a good look at it right there on the screen.
That looks rather stealth-like.
It does.
He's in no hurry.
He's just out for a Sunday stroll on a Tuesday night, isn't he?
Casey Martin could use a base hit. You go back to the game on Saturday. Casey was 0-for-5, and he got an infield hit in his last at bat. Beat out a dribbler to go 1-for-6. He's 0-for-4 with 3 Ks today. And when you're 0-for-4, those pitches suddenly are called strikes instead of balls.
I think so. Seems like borderline pitches don't go your way. And then you start chasing balls down and out of the zone.
And that's where at the big league level, you're given a little more leeway to kind of chew on an umpire. And you might say, hey, listen, I know it's 6-1. I know it's late, but I'm fighting for everything here.
Right.
I need every pitch called as is and not inflated because I'm just trying to swim my way to the shore.
That's the ball he's been chasing.
Yep.
So good. Identification of that breaking ball outside the zone by Martin. Again, you just have to think, even with the velocity of Vasilakis, you got to have that same approach up the middle the other way. Talked about how quick twitch he is and the ability to pull anything inside.
And then you get locked up on something
right
over the inner half. Start thinking away, seeing everything soft away. A little bit susceptible to hard in. When you're going like this, Troy, I can't help but think along with Casey. You're starting to think, my goodness, am I going to see a fastball? I just saw a fastball, and now I'm not going to see another one. I'm going to see a breaking ball. I'm going to swing at it.
Yeah.
I'm in my head. Two outs.
Yeah, you're exactly right. That's what's going through his head right now is it's just that pitch recognition. And then when you're pressing, you don't see the spin on the baseball very well. It's an updated score. Damn, but that's one heck of a ball game right there. 6-3 looks like that. Texas Tech scratched out another run.
I'd be curious to see what the crowd is like from that series. Would they be Biloxiites, Biloxians?
Biloxians, that sounds good.
Does it?
I'll take that.
Here's Webb. Looking for his third base hit.
We just kind of look at the comfort level of Braden Webb right here, and then just the comfort level of how Casey Martin was in that last at-bat. And I'm telling you, I've been there. I think my junior year I went about 60 at-bats hitting about 200. And it's tough when you're scuffling like that. Again, the ball looks like a BB coming at you. You don't see spin as well when you're pressing. And then when you're in the groove and everything slows down, everything looks like a beach ball coming in there.
Another big-time shallow fly ball. Smith will take it. And the inning ends. Razorbacks, I believe, have left 11 men on base. But we'll go to the ninth. Razorbacks 3 outs away from a win.
We've all been here before. The conference room. The speakerphone. The missing files. Not in the room, then you're not in the know. Well, this has been nice. But can we not? Microsoft Teams invites everyone you work with to work together. Be seen, be heard, be there when you're not. Share your files and your opinion, and maybe even a happy little fruit guy. When you're ready to unleash the power of your team, open Teams.
Can you find me the Sea of Tranquility?
Bad Moon Rising. There we go. Doesn't even look real, does it?
Well, sure does not.
It's like a light of a locomotive train coming down a tunnel.
Razorbacks this weekend will trade the Sea of Tranquility for Starkville. They'll have a one-game series at Bricktown Ballpark in Oklahoma City against the Sooners on the 17th. Then Alabama, the surprising Crimson Tide, will be in here for 3 games in a couple of weekends. I think I've changed my mind on the schedule for Arkansas because his best steps in against Monk. I've talked about it many times. This is the year Arkansas goes to Mississippi State, Ole Miss, LSU. These are three difficult places to play. Even when those teams aren't elite teams, those are tough places to win games. And then you think about the teams that come here in those off years, but Florida and Georgia coming to – I think you'd almost rather have those two teams here and take your chances going to LSU and Ole Miss.
Right. You're absolutely right. But the only team Arkansas doesn't draw this season is Vanderbilt. Those are some tough places. Duty Noble Field down in Starkville, it's a rocking place. The box is always tough. Swayze Field in Oxford.
Off the bat of Bess towards Webb. That's one out. Washington Jr., by the way, stayed in for Kerstad after he pinch ran for Heston when he was hit by a pitch on that arm or wrist back in the eighth.
Now batting number two, Drew Smith.
Monks tried to go 3 scoreless after McIntyre gave up the 1 run in 6 innings. He's about to get his first collegiate W. Strew Smith bats. Razorbacks trying to win their 10th game of the year against five defeats. Well, there's your ice bag. I'm encouraged by the fact that he's not in a van going to the emergency room.
Right. I think all Razorback fans are feeling the same thing, too.
Casey double clutches another one that he skips and another one that Austin scoops.
I talked about with Dave Van Horn about Cole Austin at first base, and he said, man, he is an absolute vacuum over there. Almost kind of reminds you of what Trevor Ezell would do at first base. And got to remember, Cole Austin, he's a converted third baseman. So I guess a guy that's used to picking balls off the bat and short hops in the hot corner, he just makes that look easy over there at first.
Because it's not.
No. I'll tell you what, Casey Martin's his best friend right now because he saved him two throwing errors.
I'd like to have a radar gun on a couple of those throws over to first, but nonetheless, Austin has scooped them, and here is Weaver pinch hitting in the ninth as the Lopes are down to their final out. Two Razorback pitchers trying to scatter eight hits and give up just one run tonight. Monks buried that two-strike pitch.
It was one of those pitches. I'm not going to give up an 0-2 hit. I'll spike it instead.
He succeeded. That was a late swing by Weaver.
He took that one out of Opitz's glove, didn't he?
He almost jumped to do it, too.
It was behind him.
Foul ball off the bat of Weaver. He remains alive.
He's definitely getting his money's worth. He's scrapping up there at the plate, isn't he?
Batting for Burton. That is a foul ball again. Opitz has been in there for the duration.
Wonder if he's going to get a day off tomorrow.
He might be wondering the same thing. Wants this pitch in. Went right into the Razor. That almost hit Kerstad again. Stop that!
Somebody protect him.
Somebody jump in front of Kerstad. Watch him put up his other arm to deflect the ball.
Your curse said you got to be around, not a pitcher. You got to be around another fielder. Yeah.
Ball game. And the Razorbacks win it 6-1, leading from beginning to end.
Well, really good outing by Will McIntyre and Caden Monk coming in for Arkansas, and that's just what the doctor ordered as far as midweek pitching goes.
You're right, midweek, it doesn't do much better than that as far as the pitching, and the Razorbacks get 12 singles today. Scratch out their runs.
They really did, but again, it was all about the mound for Arkansas. They had a big second inning and cruised to a 6-1 victory.
That'll do it tonight from Baumwalker Stadium. That was the lone run for the Lopes at Atlanta back on the field. So for Troy Eklund and our entire crew, I'm Brett Dolan, thanking you for watching. Again tomorrow, 4 Eastern, 3 Central, the finale of this series. Once again, our final tonight, Arkansas 6, Grand Canyon 1. Good night, everybody.